Welcome, happy Sabbath. To those of you that are here, also those that are watching us on our streaming services. You know, it's raining here in Richmond, and I don't know, and some other parts of the country. I know in New York City, I spoke to my sister earlier on, and it's raining there as well. But I'm so glad that you guys can make it and spend some time together. Always important to be with the church community. But as I think about the mission, vision, values that we have that I was asked to share with you this morning, which you already know, the one that maybe sometimes we always now saying two different ones is the mission, right? Building bridges to God. And some people are still saying the old one, building bridges back to God. So, you know, why the difference, right? And back when we designed these mission, vision, and values, one of the things that we were looking at is how do we go ahead and bring people back that have left? That was the part of the big thing for us at the time. But as our Pastor Scott and the team, leadership team, looked at these things now as it pertains to 2023, a bridge is a bridge, right? And it has to be regardless of somebody that left or somebody that's coming in new. And so that's why it was so important to change the mission to building bridges to God. We want to build that bridge. And I had a joke with one of our former pastors who helped us develop these mission, vision, and values. I used to say to him, your mission is really burning the bridges to light the way, because he came here, spent a year, and then a year and a half, and then left quickly. So it was a joke among us. But really, as you look to the future, as you look as the way you're dealing with your friends, your family, your visitors, try to be that bridge. And as you think about the values, think about how you incorporate that and help others as well. And as you look at also the vision for the church, think about how do I incorporate all of these things, and what do they have in common or don't have in common with those that I have for myself? Because as we think about this as a church, we should also think about these things for our personal lives and how they connect with the church that we worship. So I encourage you to think about these things, but if you forget everything that I said, let's be that bridge that brings those people to God and that connect them to God. May God bless you this morning.
This time we're going to invite our children to come up for our children's story and to take up the children's offering. So I know there's some children here, so come on up and we will do that now.
Children's song. Wait. Who wants the microphone today? Nobody? If you guys want to take a seat here. And family, can we say a warm welcome to my friend Caitlin?
Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. Go Zacchaeus. Well, hello there. Come on in. Sit a spell. Take your shoes off. Good morning, boys and girls. I know we got more children than this. There are two right there. Come on up. Enjoy us. Okay. Well, tell me something. Have you guys ever had someone to treat you bad, say bad things, just be mean to you? Yeah, of course, we got some of those. And I'm going to tell you a story about a little man. His name was Zacchaeus. And they said that he was a wee little man. How tall he was, I don't know. But the song says he was a wee little man. Zacchaeus was a tax collector. You know what that is? Your mom and dad knows, because this is the time of the year we're paying the last taxes in Chesterfield for the year. So Zacchaeus was a man that collected money for taxes. And the people said that Zacchaeus was cheating them. He was stealing their money. And they didn't like him. But you know something? Zacchaeus heard that Jesus was coming to Jericho. And he wanted to see Jesus for himself because he had heard that Jesus loves everybody. And they sure didn't like Zacchaeus at all. Well, anyway, Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus, and the crowds were all around. And by him being so small in stature, he couldn't see Jesus. He was up on his tiptoes. And the thought came to him, I'm going to get up in the sycamore tree. And that's what he did. He climbed up in a tree. And as Jesus was passing by, Jesus looked up in that tree. And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down, because I need to go to your house today. Wouldn't you like to have Jesus come to your house? Huh? Well, let me tell you something. He's with us all the time, isn't he? He's in our hearts. And so the moral of this story is that regardless of what you have going on in your life, you can always have the grace of God in your heart. Okay? Who would like to pray for us? I need someone to pray this morning. I know I can always count.
Okay. Dear Jesus, thank you that we can all be here today. Thank you that we get to spend time with the children. Thank you that we all made it, even though it's raining. In thy name I pray, amen.
Hello, church family. Now is the time to set aside for giving. There are multiple ways to give: online at our church website, through our center app, by texting any amount to 84321. And there's also a box right behind the center camera. Thank you for supporting the church. Happy Sabbath.
Good morning, church. Our first song is going to be Joy to the World.
Oh. Come here, come here to prayer. Shabbat Shalom, a happy Sabbath. Amen. Max LeCoq, sometimes our prayers are feeble. Sometimes our prayers are minute. But it's not, the power is not in the one that says it. It's in the one that hears it. Amen. I don't know about you, but this has been a rough time. A rough time since Thanksgiving. I got a phone call yesterday. My sister had a stroke. My older sister had a stroke. I found out one of my best friends died. With all the shooting and killing that's going on in the communities, it's affecting those who we come in contact with. But there's something that we can do, and that is push. Say push. What does push stand for? I can't hear you. It says pray until something happens. So I want you to push. Come on, push. Push. Push, because we are struggling against forces that we have no power over except through him. Amen? So we have to push, because every day when we wake up, whether we go to work, riding down the highway, there's a struggle. It's a pushing. People cutting us off, people walking into grocery stores, shooting up people. The other day at my job, and we're going to pray, a guy walked in, was playing basketball on the court in his work boots. You don't play on the court. He came upstairs. He went into the weight room. Lady told him to cut his earphones down because he was playing all this secular music, talking about sex and that there. He came out and went ballistic. He walked out the building through the basketball across the parking lot on Route 10. He got in his car. He drove back around, got out the car, and started to the building. I said, y'all need to stop him. He walked in the building. And everybody stood there. I said, he could have had a gun and killed every last one of us. We are right now, we need to push. We need to pray until something happens, that Yeshua Jesus comes back. We need to pray. If there's anyone in here who needs prayer, just stand up. Just stand up. And we're going to pray. Father God, we thank you once again for allowing us to see this set-apart day that you have made for us, that we can come together as a family and community to help further your kingdom. I ask you, Father, that you bless those on the sound of my voice. I don't know what they're going through, but you know what they're going through. I ask that you put the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, upon them from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. Bless each one that as we go through the service today and hear the message being brought by my brother, my friend, that Father God, you just touch our hearts and minds so that we can build bridges that we can do in this community and other communities. This is my prayer. If you agree, say amen and amen.
At this time, I'd like to invite Dr. Anderson to come forward. As he's coming up, let me tell you about who this giant of a man is. I mean giant from a spiritual standpoint. Now,
thank you.
Dr. Anderson was my boss, but neither one of us knew it. I was a chaplain endorsed by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. I was a chaplain for 7 years. And during that time, you were in charge of the Adventist Chaplain Ministry. So indirectly, he was my boss at one point. Neither one of us really knew that. Let me tell you about this man. There's earned, and there's given, and there's called. Do you know? This man has earned not one, not two, not three, but 4 master's degrees. on top of that, he decided that wasn't enough. He went and got his doctorate in, what was that again?
Ministry.
Doctorate in ministry.
Leadership.
Now, not only that, that's a lot, right? That's a lot. But not only that, he is a commander in the U.S. Navy, retired after 26 years of service.
Thank you.
He earned so many things, but that's not the important part. He was given. He was given his beautiful wife, Deborah. They were given two children. They were given how many grandchildren?
Four.
Four grandchildren. But that's not enough. He was given grace. And then he was called. And because he was called, all these other things have happened. He was called into the ministry, the gospel ministry of Jesus Christ, mm-hmm. for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And you have served over
37 years.
Because of all this, he is standing before us today, and we are thankful. We praise God that he is here, and he is going to introduce something that I'm excited about, that we'll hear more about through the sermon and then at the end of the service as well. Thank you, Dr. Anderson.
Thank you for the invitation. Good morning, Courthouse Road.
Good morning.
I am thrilled and feel very privileged to spend the Sabbath here with you. Deborah and I got up early and left before the sun came up, so you never know what's going to happen on 95 South, but we got here, and to God be the glory. I want to talk to you this morning about transformational grace. I know a lot of things, but the thing that has made the most difference in my life is the transformational grace of God. And you may not have been at the bottom of life yet, but every day we wake up breathing, there's transformational grace. I would like to direct your attention to a verse of scripture this morning, Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. But before we read it, I want you to join me in what has become a devotional habit of mine. Whenever I study the Bible or get ready to read the Bible or preach, I look at it, I hold it up, and I say, "This is my Bible. In it, I learn that Jesus loves me, Jesus died for me, and Jesus rose for me. This is my Bible. In it, I learn that he's coming back for me so that we can live with him in a ceaseless, sinless eternity." Do you believe that? Then I want you to hold your Bible up, whether it's electronic or paper, whatever you're using, and I want you to repeat after me with gusto. Are you ready? Gusto. Are you ready? This is my Bible. In it I learn that Jesus loves me, Jesus died for me, and Jesus rose for me. This is my Bible. In it I learn that he's coming back for me so that we can live with him in a ceaseless, sinless eternity. Let me pray. Thank you, dear God, for this morning, Sabbath. This is the day the Lord has made, and I am glad and rejoicing in it. I thank you for bringing the individuals who are here today in person and those who are here virtually. Thank you for this moment. Now bless us in these next minutes as we talk about your transformational grace and how to overcome our fears. In Jesus' name, amen. So I want to thank the pastor and the staff of the church for inviting me here on this day, an inaugural day of Adventist Recovery Ministries. And everybody is recovering. I stand here today as a sinner saved by grace, recovering from all the effects of sin that was around me and sin that is in me. Thanking God for Jesus Christ. Our verse of scripture, Romans chapter 12, verse 2, says, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what is God's will, his good, his pleasing, and perfect will." I want to say to you this morning, brothers and sisters, that fear is the greatest detriment and the greatest residue of sin. Because of sin, we become afraid. Fear is almost natural and innate to us because of original sin. I submit to you today that fear, anger, and unforgiveness are the taproot of most addictions and aberrances that we live through. But I also submit to you that our transformations occur when by faith in Christ, we embrace our salvation and we confront the fears that undergird our failings. I submit to you today that unreasonable fears are not common. The human being is only born with two fears. Every other fear is learned. Two fears. They are simply the fear of loud, sudden noises and the fear of falling. Tested with an infant. They don't know what a snake looks like. They don't know what an eagle looks like. They don't know what danger is, except if you clap your hand beside their ear while they're sleeping, they'll flinch. Do it again, they'll flinch, but a little less. Do it again, they flinch even less. Do it a fourth time, the baby almost always ignores it. It overcomes the fear by the sense of security of being in that bassinet or in that crib, on that mattress, under the blanket, under the care of the mother and the father, if they know him, that they feel gives security. We've got a father who's everlasting. A father who's everywhere, a father who knows everything, and a father who has a plan for us that overarches experiences that we may have. I want to talk to you today about seven fears. I'll be brief because I don't want you to go to sleep. I'll be brief, so you got to listen fast because I'm going to be moving quickly. The first fear that we deal with in life is FOMO. Have you heard of it? The fear of missing out. And we still are susceptible to that fear, no matter how young we are or how old we may get. I can confess this now because I'm old. But the first time I remember tasting something I should not have because I grew up Adventist, but I was on a school bus with some boys. And they were kind of cool. And they had some Bacardi rum. I didn't even know what it was. But I knew I shouldn't have it. But when they offered it to me, I thought, if I don't do this, I am going to miss out on being cool. Being cool wasn't that important. And if you're young and you're listening to me here today, being cool is not important enough to sacrifice your integrity and the principles upon which your life is based. In fact, if you overcome that fear of missing out and stand firm for what you know and believe, you'll be the cool kid after a while. You know, we could talk about Daniel 2 and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who withstood this idea of fear of missing out and stood firm for what was true, what was right, what was good, and what was holy. And God blessed them, and they were the people that the entire nation wanted to emulate. I mean, who else got thrown into a furnace 7 times hotter than normal and came out with the approbation of God? They were literally the cool ones in the midst of the fire. But there's another fear that we as human beings, especially as we grow and mature, there's a fear of dying. Genesis chapter 20, verse 11, kind of speaks to that. Here we have Abraham talking to God. Abraham, a man whom God spoke to directly and immediately and told him that he would survive and he would have more children than stars in the sky. But he got scared and he feared for his life because he has a pretty wife. I got a pretty wife. I've been blessed in that regard. But Abraham said to God, when God said, why didn't you believe? Well, I said to myself, the Bible says, there is surely no fear of God in this place, and they will kill me because of my wife. So he lied. She's not my wife. She's my sister. I gotta just throw this experience in, and I'll promise not to keep it too long. But Deborah and I and the kids were traveling back from Virginia Beach. We'd been at a Potomac Conference workers' meeting, and my car broke down. And it was having a problem, and we coasted into a little gas station out in the middle of who knows where, or maybe God only knows where, because he was there with me. And so the car's broke. We can't drive it. We're sitting in this gas station, and this big guy comes in, and he's drunk. And he looks around while we're waiting for a tow truck to come and get the car. He looks around. He sees me. He sees my children. And he sees my gorgeous wife. And I thought to myself, God is not in this man. And he starts to make some overtures toward my wife, and I start thinking, David slew Goliath, and God is with me like he was with David. And my fear left me. But fortunately, God intervened, and the man left. God sent an angel, I believe, to deliver us from that evil. I'm here to tell you that even in this life, with all the evil that's happening around us, because you have embraced Christ as your Lord and Savior, death is going to happen to all of us unless God comes before we die. And so the issue is not so much how we die. The power of our life is in how we lived. So it doesn't matter how you die, because nothing can separate you from the love of God, not even death. Amen. So get over the fear of dying and live with the joy of the Lord. The third one is the fear of insufficiency or lack. Now, it's important to be good stewards of what God has given us. And we ought to make investments. I always told my children, I want you to live like rich people. And they thought, oh, take me to the store. And so I did. And they had whatever little money they had, they wanted to spend it all. And I said, rich people never spend all they have. And that's how they become rich. But you know, in so many places, we speak lack. We fear that if we don't have enough, something bad will happen to us. But God is the owner of that mythological cattle on a thousand hills. God is the God of all sufficiency, not the God of insufficiency. If you don't have enough, but you've been faithful, and let me just, I'm diverting from script now, but let me say something about faithfulness. Men who are heads of households, you need never fear a lack of sufficiency if you're treating your spouse right and the women in your life with honor and you're being faithful in your stewardship. God will provide. Amen. Deborah and I had a newborn baby, just 4 or 5 weeks old, 6 weeks old. We moved into a new apartment building and it took our last dime to get in. But we got the house all ready. I put the crib together. We cleaned up everything and the house was immaculate, but we had no money. I'm not talking a few dollars. We had nothing. And we went to take all the trash down to the dumpsters. Remember this? And we came back in. We lived on the fourth story of an apartment building. The door was locked. The windows were closed. No one could have gotten in that apartment building. And we came back in. We prayed before we took the trash out. And we looked in the baby's room. He was in the crib. And in the middle of the floor was a brand new, never been folded, $50 bill. Brings tears to my eyes when I think about it, but God will provide. Faithfulness is the key. Genesis 21:17 talked about that lack of sufficiency, and it says about Hagar and her son. God heard the boy crying. God will hear your tears, your pleas, your petitions. God will hear. And he called out to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What is the matter? And to, what's the matter, Hagar?" And he said to her, "Do not be afraid. Don't be afraid. Be faithful and look for God's intervention. And don't be afraid to rely upon your network of fellowship, your friends, your community, your family. Sometimes friends are closer than family." Let me hasten on. The fourth one is found in Matthew 14, five verses, Matthew 14, 27 through 32. This is the fear of being overwhelmed. We all have this fear of being overwhelmed, that life is too much to bear. And when we try to bear up under overwhelming situations, it has a corrosive impact upon our cognitive abilities, upon our creativity, and even upon your physicality, your emotions, and your spirituality. And this is found in this story in Matthew chapter 14, 27 through 32. This is about Peter and Jesus. Peter, the disciples have been dispatched to go on to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And they're out there in the middle of the ocean, and they see what they thought was a ghost. Spiritualism is not new. It existed back then. They were familiar with apparitions and ghosts and that kind of thing, that phenomenon. And so they thought they saw a ghost as they came closer. They thought it looked like Jesus. And Peter says, "If it is you, call me out into the water." And so, come on. And Peter steps out of the boat. A lesson here is that if you want to experience the miraculous power of God, sometimes you got to step out of your comfort zone. Our comfort zones are the barks upon which we try to steer our way across the sea of life. But sometimes, to experience the glory, the grace, the majesty, the power, the miraculous presence of God, you got to get out of the boat. Peter stepped out of the boat, even while the winds were blowing and the waves were rising and billowing. He stepped out of the boat because he had his eyes on Jesus. The Bible story implies that as long as he was looking confidently in the eyes of Jesus, or toward the person of Jesus, he had buoyancy. But when he looked away and looked at the waves and listened to the winds of strife around him, of discontent, of malcontent, of discouragement that we sometimes hear that take our eyes off Christ, he began to sink. But the story says that he cried out, "Help me, Lord." And immediately he was back into the embrace of his loving Savior. We need not fear overwhelming circumstances, but we need to, in the midst of them, go to the person of Christ and say, "What would you have me to do in this situation? And there's another fear. That's a fear of failure. Because we oftentimes feel like if we do what God calls us to do, we might fail. Numbers 14:9. Most of the time in biblical stories, the motivation of Christ to do something different has been counterintuitive. Here we've got a patriarch who's about to do something no one's ever done before. Moses telling his people, don't rebel against the Lord, Joshua. And do not be afraid of the people of the land, because we will devour them. Their protection is gone. But, and this is the big thing in life, the Lord is with us. Do not be afraid of them. Joshua knew that the Lord would be with him wherever he went. David knew that God had anointed him and ordained him for leadership. And though we might make bad decisions, when we get ourselves back into the embrace of God, that transformational grace puts us back on track and will deliver us into that vision that God has for our lives. So don't be afraid of them, because God is with us. The sixth one, and I'm almost about to close. Matthew 14, 25 and 26 talks about the fear of the unknown and evil. Fear of the unknown and evil. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. Another apparition, maybe? Something they'd rarely experienced before. But when he identified himself, they felt good. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said. And they cried out in fear. Is that Matthew 14, 25 and 26? And realizing, once they realized who he was, the fear was abated. Here's the reason why I'm sharing this one. Fear of the unknown can be frightening. When you don't know where you're landing. But when you know that your landing zone is the will of God, then you know that you're going to be all right no matter what and come what may. In my childhood, I never lived anywhere longer than 3 years. And my early adulthood life, never lived anywhere longer than 3 years. And wherever my father was moved, it was a place we'd never been before. I was born in Washington, D.C. We moved to Haines City, Florida. From Haines City, Florida, we went to Wilmington, North Carolina, where I started school at 6 years old. After Wilmington, North Carolina, we went to Roanoke, Virginia. Never been there before. Went to a bigger school, public school. Kids I didn't know. A neighborhood we'd never been to. And then we moved from Roanoke, Virginia, a relatively small city, to Chicago, Illinois. But we weren't afraid. Why? Because our Father took us there. Our Father took us there. Our Father found us a home. Our Father prepared the way. He had some rules. Don't go out starting fights. But if you get in one, don't get your butt beat. He took care of us. When we realize that God is our Father, that he has gone to prepare a place for us. And that because he's gone to prepare a place for us, he's coming back to get us so that where he is, there we may also be. Paraphrase of John 14, 1 through 3, because it applies in our lives even now. God has promised never to leave us nor to forsake us. I shared these fears with you this morning, the fear of missing out, the fear of death, the fear of being overwhelmed, a fear of failure, a fear of the unknown and of evil. But God has promised that he wouldn't leave us nor forsake us. God said something about being the one who is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before the throne of grace. The thing I want you to take away from this sermon today is not those six debilitating fears. I want you to take away this last one, because this last one is the antidote for all those other things. It is the fear of the Lord. Genesis 22:12 and Exodus 20:20, look them up this afternoon, read them, wrestle with them, rehearse them in your minds, and know that God believes in you. So I appeal to you today, my brothers and sisters, receive the spirit of abundant life in Jesus Christ. Cast all your cares and fears on him. Embrace your salvation and walk into the successes that God has ordained for your life. Can you receive that this morning? And I'd like you to stand with me in that reception as I offer a closing prayer to this moment of sermonic ministry. Thank you, dear God, for this morning, for your congregation here in the room and those in other rooms all over the world. Thank you for this Sabbath day. Thank you for the affirmation of your goodness, your transformational grace, and your mercy on our behalf. I pray, dear God, that you would renew, restore, reinvigorate that fear of the Lord that frees us from other fears, because those fears are debilitating. But our respect for who you are, our embrace of your omniscience, omnipotence, and omnipresence gives us courage, gives us wisdom, gives us fortitude to walk away from the things that might doth easily beset us. This I pray because you are our most significant other. You are our superpower, the one that transforms, the one that saves, the one that restores, the one that regenerates. I pray that you'll do that for each of us now, tomorrow, and every day until you come. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you, and thank you for being co-worshipers with us today. God bless.
Grab one of those brochures on your way. And then, Dr. Anderson, if you could return. So, about 5 months ago, I met this guy who said, we need to have a meeting. I need to talk to you about something. And I said, okay. So we came here to the church. It was pouring rain outside, like cats and dogs. Like they never see out west, that kind of rain. And so he comes in and he finds he's dripping wet. And then we sit down out here in the lobby and he says, I want to tell you about something. I was like, what's that? He says, ARM, Adventist Recovery Ministries. I want to tell you about this because I am passionate about this. I want to do that in this church. Now, our mission is about building bridges to God. So one day, Ken and Lillian show up at our church and said, we just felt called to come to your church today. And since that day, they have been here almost every single week, unless they've been away for a funeral or something like that. They've been here. And as Ken starts telling me about Adventist Recovery Ministries, I start to get excited. But he said that you brought it here from Andrews. Well, not here to Potomac, but he brought it to Allegheny East, right? And this is where you got to know it, and I'm just going to sit back and let you guys talk now.
Well, let me say that I was privileged to come to Pottstown, Pennsylvania at my first church after seminary. And Ken and his family were members of that church. And Ken was one of the deacons, and we became like brothers. Our hearts knit together in ministry. And because of a focus on regeneration ministries and the need that we had in our community, because when I got to the church, there were beer bottles and some needles and condoms on the steps of the church. And I thought, this isn't good. On the corner down here, if the church is here, the corner down here was, the Elks Club was up here, and the bar, what's the name of the bar, do you remember?
Little's Bar. And so our church lot was the confluence of where folk would meet after they'd had their parties on Friday night. So Ken and a couple of the other deacons went with me down to Little's Bar to say, could you do something different here? And we went to the Elks Club. I said, could you do something a little different here? I wasn't afraid because I was new to the community. They were afraid for me because they knew the community. But in the end, we wound up having anti-drug parades in the city. And it was meaningful in transitioning that community and built a relationship with the pastor, the Baptist church, and the AME church. And our three congregations worked together to make a difference in the community. Now, that's my side.
And on my side, those that he's talking in the church, we grew up in the community. And we were part of that crew with the drugs and the alcohol, and we would come into the church, and we would sit in the back of the church. Most of us were Adventists, but we was in there because of our wives and family, but we were sitting in the back after just coming from partying. So one Sabbath, my first wife had called the pastor, and she said, you need to talk to Ken. I'd been out all night partying and getting high, and I never forget when y'all lived up in Mount Penn, and they were just building apartments, and he and I went out and walked across the field in the back, and we started talking. And then he said, when I come back from Andrews University, I'm going to talk to you more. When he came back, he had a folder about this big, and he said, I want to introduce you to regeneration. And we sat and we talked, and I read through it, and I talked to a couple of friends. We put it in the newspaper. I was still in recovery. And my brother who's sitting back here who don't want to come here as a co-founder, James Jackson back there, he was going to an AA convention in Seattle, Washington. And he called us and Pastor Paul came to me and said, James Jackson wants to talk to you. He will get with you when we came back. and we were on fire because we saw the need. But we saw in him, now he was younger than all of us. Just coming out of seminary, went to Pine Forge Academy, some of the members were in his class. But he sat with us non-judgmental. And he poured himself in there that we had no choice but to stand beside him. And we were afraid for him because across the street, there was a dealer where we used to cop all the time. That's a word for getting the drugs. And one day they walked into church and he was in the church by himself. And when he came and told us what happened, we went to the brother and said, that's a no-no. That's a no-no. He can leave the church door open. Don't go over there. So everybody in the community knew, don't mess with on the street, Seventh-day Adventist Church. The bar, and as he said, we did the drug. But it is that when we start doing the ministry, it cleaned us up. It cleaned me up. It brought me back that I said, hey, when I needed somebody to talk to, this is who I went to. And that's the whole purpose of transformation, mm-hmm. grace.
An interesting dynamic was even before we got the focus of regeneration, some of the members had been approached about, could we host an AA meeting in the church? I thought it was a good idea. And so we took it to the church board, and they said no, because they might drink coffee and smoke. They said absolutely not. And then this. And when the church members began to realize, or they already knew it, confront the fact that there are people in the church who have addictive personalities, if not working to recover from a substance abuse or bad behavior. And when they began to realize that the evidence of need was in the house, it was received. And we started, back then it was SDAXA, and Regeneration Ministries was the first church on the East Coast to have that. And they became evangelists for transformational grace and how God restores. And the church became that nexus. It's like if you drop a pebble in a still pond and the ripples, they became the ripple effect throughout Columbia Union and the rest of the country.
We had at the height of it, we had 160 different groups from Allegheny East to Columbia Union that we went up and down and spoke at the churches. And judgment begins in the household of faith.
Well.
And you would be surprised. We weren't surprised, but people would not admit. But once church was over, they were coming to us and saying, my family, families have grown together. Churches have grown to this day that it multiplied. And it went from regeneration to Adventist Recovery Ministry because they saw what we were doing.
So let me interrupt you really quick. So what's the difference between AA, NA, SA, all the A's, and ARF?
The difference is it's that God is over top of this. We're not talking about just our higher power. We're talking about the power.
Yes.
Come on now. See, the higher power can be anything. Ellen G. White talks about pantheism. That's what AA and NA talk about when they talk about the higher power. This can be my higher power. And I had to pull away from that. And when I looked at what we were looking at, the steps of Christ that we used, the biblical comparisons, it was like, this is nothing new. Sin has always been, is how that it's always been. So this is when we start talking about our power, the power of the one that created everything. That was the difference. So that when we went to AA, people in AA and NA begin to understand, wait a minute, and they start drifting toward us because they start seeing that, hey, I've been duped. I've been told, no, it's about him. Creation is not him. He is creation. Mm-hmm. And that's where the difference came.
And you know, an interesting thing about that program, the difference between AA and ARM, is the absence of fear. I think the originators of AA had a God concept, a God connection. They were spiritual people, but in order to make it acceptable, they went to an unnamed higher power that anybody could say, well, this is my higher power, Jim Beam or Old Crow or, you know, but we're not afraid to say that this reformation, this transformation comes through the power of the living, indwelling Jesus Christ.
Amen. And we are actually going to have an impromptu meeting right here at the end of the service, which we're almost there. If you are interested in being a part of this, if you know somebody in your life that would fit into that category, or if you don't want to say right now, I want to keep praying about it, but I want to bring it to Ken, bring it to me, and then we can talk about this. We're actually going to, our target is to start a meeting here in the church in January.
Can I interject one more thing?
Yes.
It is easy for churched people to say, well, I don't do drugs. I'm 65 years old. When I was 18, I applied for a job with the FBI. And they have these security things. And I checked on there that I had never smoked a joint. They didn't believe that an 18-year-old African-American had never smoked a joint. I'm 65. I have never smoked a joint. But I have been addicted to anger. I have been addicted to perfectionism, judgmentalism, and other kinds of things that might be more toxic. I'm just saying.
There's, and I want to hit back on this. AA actually started in the church.
Yeah, that's right.
With the Oxford group. The church was judgmental. That's why they took it away from the church and made it a disease. What we have to realize is that there, when we look at the overall, sin is sin. Mm-hmm. There is no degree. And when we look at from a sin perspective, we start seeing that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. One of my favorite, Gerald May, he said, to live is to be addicted. And to be addicted is to live. Mm. Because people, places, and things, that's some of our addictions.
That's right. Well, at this time, we're going to go ahead and have a closing prayer. But after the service, if this is something that speaks to your heart, we'd like to invite you to just to come right up here to this area right here, and we'll have maybe a 10 or 15 minute just discussion on what this looks like and how you can be a part of it. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you so much for today. Thank you so much for this church. Thank you so much for this community. Thank you so much that Dr. and Deborah Anderson were able to come down and to be with us today. Lord, we ask you to continue to be with both of their ministries, continue to shine through them. Lord, be with this church. May we reach out to this community in a new way, not just outside, but also the people that are struggling with addiction right here and within our doors. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Happy Sabbath.